thank you so much for joining us this morning. Please take your Bibles and open up at the book of Genesis. This morning, we're continuing with our study through the book of Genesis, our mini-series of roughly about 7 sermons. And this morning, let me start by asking you 2 questions. And ask these questions for yourself. What am I? And who am I? What am I? Who am I? These are the most fundamental questions any person can ask themselves. These questions, what am I? Who am I? They remain crucial whether you are saved or unsaved. Whether you are a Christian or a heathen, agnostic or atheist, we all have to answer these questions. Who am I? What am I? How you answer these questions? Since my remote's not working, Jovan, can you maybe just go on to the next slide? There we go. Okay. Just forgot to put it on. How you answer these 2 questions reveal your worldview. It indicates by what and how your worldview was shaped. Your worldview is that fancy term that we use for the lens, the glasses, through which you interpret everything and everyone. How would you answer those 2 questions? What am I? Who am I? The reason these 2 questions are so utterly important is because it reveals to us what we think our purpose is, and where we find our identity in life. Have you noticed what is one of the biggest pandemics among young people today? It's identity crisis. Identity crisis. The reason these 2 questions are so utterly important is because it reveals to us what we think our purpose is and where we find our identity. If we were to go back in time, we have a time machine and we travel 80 years into the past. Who of you knows a man by the name of Adolf Hitler? Right? The very famous archetype of evil, the German Führer, the leader of Germany, the initiator of World War II. If you were to ask him those 2 questions, Hitler, what are you? Who are you? He most probably would have answered in the following way. I am the leader. And I am superior. You see, Hitler not only believed that about himself, but he also led the supermajority of the German nation to believe that about themselves. When Hitler took control of the German government in the year 1931, it didn't take long for him to start a nationwide fumigation project. You see, Hitler was a bit of a germaphobe. He was obsessed with creating order and cleanliness. So he issued a mandate across all of German-controlled territories that all houses, all factories, all workshops are to be fumigated to exterminate rats and other insects. And the project was a massive success. You see, they used this type of gas that was relatively a new invention back in those days. It's called Zyklon gas. Zyklon gas. It would later be relabeled, but you see, Zyklon had this distinct odor to it. If you stepped into a building or a factory, it had this rotten smell to it. So you would know, oh no, they're busy fumigating, I had to get out, otherwise I would die if you stepped into a building and breathed in that gas, that toxins. That's the type of gas that Hitler used to exterminate all these rodents and pests. Years later, Hitler started a different fumigation project. He started up collecting and rounding up all the quote-unquote undesirables within Germany. Jews, gypsies, homosexuals, anyone basically not German or not seen as German enough. And they were later then placed into gas chambers. He used a gas called Zyklon. Just the same type of gas he used to kill off the rats and the insects, he used to kill all these undesirable people. It shows us what he thought of his victims. You see, Hitler did not see his acts of genocide as murder. After killing 6 million Jews, he would not have confessed to having done anything wrong. He didn't kill anyone. He killed pests. He killed rodents, the same as you would kill rats and insects. Therefore, he did not view it as murder. You see, Hitler answered those two questions, what am I and who am I, in a very different way than most of us would answer them here this morning. But do you see the way he answered it ultimately shaped the course of all of human history? What am I and who am I? And so depending on who you ask, depending on what you've been influenced by, you will get a multitude of different answers. Some will say that we are nothing more than biological machines. You see, the only difference between you and your dog is that you were lucky enough to have a big enough brain in order to manipulate your environment. That's what some say. Your people who have this worldview are normally the people who on social media openly advocate for removal or depopulation of planet Earth. They are the type of people who say, well, the Earth is overpopulated, we need to start reducing the population, we need to do something. And you know what I always find curious? These people who preach this doctrine that we need to get rid of people, they are hypocrites because they never start with themselves. It's always the other people who have to be removed. But that is the conclusion if you simply conclude that, what are you? Who are you? I'm just a biological machine, the same as a cat or a dog or even a cockroach. Some would answer these two questions in terms of their sex and their gender. Have you ever wondered why homosexual people who strongly identified with the LGBTQ plus movement take so much offense when someone simply says that the Bible says that homosexuality is a sin? Do you wonder why they take so much offense? It's because they build their entire identity based on their sexual orientation. If you say homosexuality is a sin, do you know what they hear? How they interpret that? They hear, what you're telling me is that my very existence is wrong. My very presence, my very being is evil. You see, they do not differentiate between what they do in private, in other words, their sexual preferences, they do not differentiate that with who they are. They see it as one and the same. In their worldview, they are not people who practice homosexuality like some people practice heterosexuality. They aren't people who practice that. They are homosexual. They bind their identity to that, and to then go and disagree with them is, in their worldview, tantamount to wishing them dead. Because how they answer those two questions reveal their foundational identity. How they see themselves and how they see their purpose in this world is revealed by how they answer these two questions. Some would answer these questions based on their race. Their race. Their whole worldview is race-based and the struggle between races. In this worldview, nothing matters apart from your race. The amount of melanin in your skin, the pigment of your flesh. You see, our society in South Africa, and it's even more so abroad, is obsessed with this. If you simply identify yourself by your race, if that is how you identify what you are and who you are, then you are no different than the people of old who, with that same worldview, justified things like slavery and genocide. Because that's all that matters to them, is the color of someone's skin. And you see, there are more examples I can give you, but for the sake of time, let's continue. What am I? Who am I? What is the right approach? The right approach. You see, with so many different worldviews and different ways to answer these questions, how do we know which answers are the best answers? Or maybe we should state it differently, which answers are the right answers? Well, the answer to that question is actually very simple. You know, since God is the one who created us, He is the one who programmed us. He programmed us with our purpose and with our identity. We should go to Him. In other words, if you want to know what you are, if you want to know who you are, we simply need to read the instruction manual left for us by the designer, the Bible. The Bible. So without spending any more time on introductory thoughts, let's look at what God's Word says and see how God would answer those two questions. What does God say you are? Who does God say you are? So please, let's turn to Genesis chapter 1. And I love to read for us. We'll be reading selected scriptures from Genesis chapter 1 and Genesis chapter 2. But let's start in Genesis chapter 1 at verse 26. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over the livestock, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." So God created man in His own image. In the image of God, He created him. Male and female, He created them. And God blessed them. And God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over every living thing that moves on the earth." And then let's flip a page to Genesis chapter 2. Genesis chapter 2, verse 4. "These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created, in the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens, when no bush of the field was yet in the land, and no small plant of the field had yet sprung up, for the Lord God had not caused it to rain on the land, and there was no man to work the ground, and a mist was going up from the land and was watering the whole face of the ground. Then the Lord God formed the man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living creature." And then just on the second side of that page, verse 18. Follow along with me. Genesis chapter 2, verse 18. "Then the Lord God said, 'It is not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helper fit for him.' Now out of the ground, the Lord God had formed every beast of the field and every bird of the heavens and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called every living creature, that was its name. And the man gave names to all the livestock and to the birds of the heavens and to every beast of the field. But for Adam, there was not found a helper fit for him. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man. And while he slept, took one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he had made into a woman and brought her to the man. Then the man said, 'This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Therefore a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed.'" Like mentioned last time in last week's sermon, if you haven't listened to that sermon, I'd highly recommend go and listen to it. It's on YouTube. It lays the foundation for this entire mini series. But as mentioned last time, Genesis chapter 1 to 3 is what we call poetic history. Poetic history. It's not a myth. It's not fable. It's not allegory. It's not symbolism. It is true history, but written in a poetic manner, so as to emphasize and creatively outline certain truths about the creation narrative. You see, Genesis chapter 1 that we read in full last week is a wide-angled creation account of the heavens and earth. Whereas Genesis chapter 2, we now zoom in. We zoom in specifically on the six day of creation. That's why Genesis chapter 2 is repeating some of the same things said in Genesis chapter 1. It is not a second creation account. It is simply a zooming in of the sixth day of creation, giving us a more detailed account of what happened. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 to 28 that we read first, we see that God creates all the animals and the humans. And in Genesis chapter 2, we see that both Adam and the animals were made in the same way. Both are formed from the dust of the earth. The only difference between Adam, you can laugh at the joke, it's all right, okay. The only difference between Adam and the animals is that the humans were created in the image of God. Or in the words of Genesis chapter 2, God breathed into Adam. It's interesting, right? That humanity doesn't even get its own day. Humanity is simply created along with the beasts of the earth. Something that God did for Adam, however, for humanity, in contrast to all the other beasts of the earth, is God breathed into Adam. Something he did not do for the rest of his creations. You see, this unique, this very special act of God breathing into Adam is referred to in Genesis chapter 1 as being made in the image of God. Or as we mentioned last time, the correct theological term is the imago Dei, which is just a fancy theological term for what it means to be created in the image of God. So in short, when we speak of the imago Dei, you'll hear that a lot in Christian circles. It is simply referring to us being in the image of God. Or, put differently, the image of God being in us. And so, we see that God bestows this very unique blessing on humanity. This very unique blessing that not even the rest of creation get. In fact, not even the angels are ever mentioned as being made in God's image. Only humanity. Only us, only Adam and Eve. But that then brings us to a very crucial question that I'm sure many of you are asking. What does this mean? What does the imago Dei mean? What does it mean to be created in the image of God? Well, let's spend some time answering that question. And as you know by now, one of the best ways to answer what something is to start by what it is not. What it is not. What we do not mean by the imago Dei is, or the image of God, is it does not refer to our physical appearance. Some say that what it means to be created in God's image is that we look like God. That is false. Jesus himself says in John chapter 4 that God is spirit. God does not have any material shape or substance. Yes, God became a man in Jesus Christ. He took on our form, but being made in God's image has nothing to do with looking like God. Being made in God's image has nothing to do with appearance. Because if that was the case, what do you do with things like chimpanzees and monkeys and orangutan? Because they look more like us than any other animal. If you were to ask someone what looks more like a human, a hippopotamus or a chimpanzee, they're obviously going to say a chimpanzee. It even has thumbs. That's amazing. So if made in the image of God was simply referring to our physical shape, well then monkeys and chimpanzees also have some sort of image of God in them. But that's not the case. And also if you make the argument that the image of God simply refers to how we physically look, what do you say for people who are deformed? People who lost an arm or a leg or are born with a deformity. Are they now less in the image of God than those who are not born that way? No, deformities and the way we look has nothing to do with the image of God. The imago Dei, or being created in God's image, is actually a combination of things. It is not one thing. It is a combination of many things. It is not exclusively one quality, but a range of qualities and responsibilities that God bestows on humanity. Up there, we have what is called the substantive qualities given. Again, it's a big term. Doesn't matter if you remember it. That's okay. Just forget it. But if you remember it, go and brag tomorrow at work that you know some big words now. All right. It's good. You're welcome. When we say we have substantive qualities, we mean that we have intelligence, a sense of morality, rationality, and very importantly, creativity. However, to say that these things are only what it means to be made in God's image would be wrong. This is part of what it means to be made in God's image, and we'll delve into that as we continue this morning. You see, animals of different species show different forms of intelligence. Primates show creative abilities. They are even seen within the animal kingdom certain structures of morality in certain groups of animals. Like, for example, in colonies of chimps, they tend to punish chimps that are greedy. Humans, however, have a very heightened awareness of all of these qualities. And so we are different to all the rest of creation with regards to these elements, these aspects. We can only attribute our higher awareness of morality and our super intelligence compared to the rest of creation to God, because God in His nature, God is moral, creative, rational, and intelligent. That's what the Bible teaches us. You see all of these elements of God in the first three chapters of Genesis, that God Himself is a moral being, that God Himself is a creative being, that God is rational and intelligent. And hence, because we are made in God's image, we share some of those qualities of God. But that is not that's not the only thing it means to be made in God's image. You see, God breathing into us definitely set us apart from the animals with regards to these qualities. There might be some semblance of them, but not to the same degree, not even close. But being made in God's image carries with it also a form of supernatural election. Supernatural election. Now, I know that's very strange, right? How do we get that from these passages? Well, to be made in the image of God is those qualities that we call the substantive qualities, morality, rationality, creativity, and intelligence. But also to be made in God's image is to be elected by God. It is to be separated by God. As already mentioned, humans and animals were created on the same day. We don't even get our own day. Humans and animals are even created in the same way. We're not even created differently than the cattle and the horses and the dogs. We are also created from the ground of the earth that the Lord God had taken. The only difference between us and all the rest of the land-dwelling animals is that God breathed into us. In a sense, you may be able to argue that up until God breathed into Adam, he was very much just like the rest of the animals that God created on the sixth day in the same way. But God chose Adam. God separated him from the rest of the animals by breathing into him, by creating him in His own image. And so then, to be made in the image of God is also to be elected by God apart from all the rest of not just animals, but creation. This concept of election is actually a very major theme throughout the book of Genesis. If you've ever read through the book of Genesis, you'd notice that election is constantly coming up. Just as God elected Adam apart from all the rest of creation and the animals, so He elected Noah apart from all the rest of the people. The same way He elected Abraham from among all who lived in that time. The same way He chose Isaac apart from Ishmael, how He chose Jacob apart from Esau, and eventually at the end of Genesis, how He would choose Israel apart from all the other nations. The book of Genesis is full of God's election, of God's choosing. And so in summary, to be made in the image of God is part of being supernaturally and graciously elected by God, selected by God. But now, I'm sure there is another question that arises in your minds. Elected for what? Really good question. I'm glad you asked that. We are elected by God to be God's representatives here on earth. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the heavens, and over the livestock, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them. God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the heavens, and over every living thing that moves on the earth. You see, God delegates authority to humanity. He delegates that authority to humans. God could have easily taken up sole rulership of the physical and the material world. It would have been no effort to God. It would have caused him no sweat. But God then creates us in his image to go and exercise authority on his behalf. We act as God's representatives to all of nature. The Imago Dei. We act as God's representatives to all of creation. If you remember last week's sermon when we went through Genesis chapter 1, one of the points that we briefly mentioned was that there is in Genesis chapter 1 a temple motif. A temple motif, meaning that God built the creation to represent a sort of tabernacle, a sort of temple in which he is revealing himself in to us. Again, if you don't know exactly what I'm talking about, I'd invite you to go and listen to that sermon. It is on YouTube. So we find this temple motif, and there's also this priest motif throughout all of Genesis and the books of Moses. If you doubt these motifs or themes, I'd invite you just go and read Genesis and Exodus, and you would see it so clearly appear. But then in Genesis chapter 2, we read the following. Genesis chapter 2, God created man, he set him apart from creation, he elected him, and he gave him this authority. Why? Verse 15, the Lord took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and to keep it. Isn't that amazing? We often view work as such a negative thing, but did you notice that the command to work came before sin? The commandment to work and be productive and creative like God happened and was given before Genesis chapter 3, before sin came into the world. You see, work is not the result of sin. The difficulty in work arises as a result of sin. But here we see God place Adam in this garden that he made specially for them, and he gives them the commandments to work and to keep. The original Hebrew, that phrase to work, has this idea of serving. It is, in a sense, to serve the ground, to be of use to the ground. And that word to keep is better translated as to guard. Adam was to guard the earth. He was to keep the earth, just as he was to serve the earth. And so in summary, God made humanity to serve and protect the earth. That is one of the reasons that God elected us for. And notice this, as already mentioned, this was all before the fall. All of this was before sin came into the world. But Adam was created to represent God by continuing to create, by continuing to cultivate. I mean, have you ever thought about this? If everything in Genesis chapter 1 was perfect, why would God put Adam in the garden and ask him to work it? How can you improve on perfection? If something is perfect and it can change, it means it never was perfect. If something is perfect, it cannot become better because it's already perfect. But if you remember last weekend, we said Genesis chapter 1 and 2 never teaches us that everything was perfect. But it was good. It was good. And in day 6, it was very, very good. And so God creates Adam and he places him in the garden with the goal of continuing this work. God planted this garden. Now, Adam, I'm putting you in the garden as my representative. You having all authority, all dominion. You are now to continue the work that I started. Now you work, you cultivate, you build, you be creative. God didn't need Adam for this. Up until now, God has done everything solo, but he calls humanity, he elects humanity to join him, to partner with him in this creation event, this creation narrative. It's actually very similar to what we find in the New Testament when Jesus partners with us, his church, to go and preach the gospel. Do you think Jesus needs us? I promise you, if it be God's will, a tree could be placed up here and could preach a better sermon than I ever could if God willed that. But God wills to partner with humanity. He wills to work with us. And that's how he decided to glorify himself. And in the same way, we partner now with Jesus in the building of his church, the same way we were created to be God's representatives here on earth. Genesis 2 verse 19 reads the following. Now out of the ground, the Lord God had formed every beast of the field and every bird of the heavens and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called every living creature, that was its name. You see, that's such a small verse that we read, but think about how profound it actually is. The Lord God created this creature, Adam, breathed into him, and then told him, whatever you call the animals' names, that will be their names. Because up until now, who has been the only one speaking and naming things? God. Genesis chapter 1, verse 5, it says, and God called the light day and the darkness, he called night. Verse 8, and God called the expanse heaven. Verse 10, and God called the dry land earth, and the waters they were gathered together, he called seas, and so on. God has been the only one naming creation. God has been the only one speaking. And now God says to Adam, this creature from the ground, you give the animals their names. And it says at the end of verse 19, and that was their names. God didn't intervene. God didn't come and make a better suggestion. Adam, I don't know if pig is such a good name. You know, maybe call it this, you know. Whatever Adam named the animals, that was their name. It's a different way we can translate it is God abided by it. There we see something of Adam acting as God's representative on earth by even naming other creatures, other parts of God's creation, just like God did in Genesis chapter 1 and chapter 2. And so to be created in the image of God, it means to have morality and intelligence and creativity and rationality, but it also means that we were made to be representatives of God here on earth. So in conclusion, what does it mean? It means that we have all those substantive qualities, but there is more to it. It means we represent God. We share a responsibility for God's creation as we are partnering with God in keeping this creation in a way that glorifies God and benefits his creation. And since we act as God's priests here in this world, it means that we also share to some degree, some of God's attributes. I don't know if you know that word, the attributes of God. When we speak of the attributes of God, we're referring to who God is. He is holy, he is love, he is light, he is truth, he is omnipotent, omnipresent, he is all wise. To be created in God's image means we, to some degree, even share in those qualities. For example, God is love. Do we have the ability to love? Yes, we do. God is truth. Do we have the ability to delight and engage with truth? Yes. God is eternal, meaning God never has a beginning and God never has an end. But you know what's interesting about us? All of us here, we have a beginning. But you know what's interesting? All of us here have no end. Every single person will live forever, without exception. It's just a question of where. Where will you live forever? But everyone will live forever. We share that with God. God created us to be eternal beings like he is, to have no end. God has authority and sovereignty as is revealed in Genesis chapter 1. And as we also now saw from Genesis chapter 2, we as those who are made in God's image, we have a delegated authority and a delegated sovereignty in the realm of our sphere, in the sphere of our responsibilities. God has creativity. People, we have this great joy and blessing of being creative. And God is rational, and yes, it means we are also rational. And so to be made in the image of God, to have the Imago Dei, is to be a priest, a representative of God, but also a mediator. A mediator. Who of you, I'm sure most of you know that word, a mediator. A mediator is someone that is able to stand between two parties of conflict or two parties that need to engage, and they are able to navigate the communication between these two parties. Why did Jesus have to become a man? Why did God have to take on human flesh? Because how could God be a mediator between us and Him? Who will represent us before God? No one. No one can. But now Christ became a man, fully human, fully God, and He is now able to represent God and represent humanity in one person, in Christ. And you see, Adam was also made as a mediator. Adam was made from dust, but he received divine breath. Adam was made from the ground, is a creation of the natural realm, but God breathed in him, so at the same time, he is a creation of the supernatural realm. He is a mediator between both realms, the natural and the supernatural. And this is why the Apostle Paul refers to Adam as the first mediator, the first head. And then, that is why Paul then also refers to Christ as the last Adam or the second Adam, because he is the fulfillment of what Adam could never be. Just like the first Adam represented all of humanity, the second Adam, Jesus Christ, represents all those who trust in Him, who are now His. And so it is important to know that when we speak about the image of God, if someone asks you, what am I, who am I, you tell them, well, what I am is, I am created in the image of God to bear certain qualities of God. His love, truth, rationality, creativity. But it also means that I am God's representative here on earth. We are created to represent God here on earth for His creation. And this Imago Dei, this created in God's image, is something that is applicable to both men and women. I'm sure I don't have to say that, but just in case, let me emphasize that. It is not only for Adam, but it was also true of Eve. Also true of Eve. And next week, we'll be jumping into the last part of Genesis chapter 2, and we are going to be looking at this relationship between Adam and Eve. And I want to invite you, if there's any sermon I don't want you to miss. Listen, if this sermon is boring, okay, I apologize, but next week's sermon is so crucial, and it is so beautiful, the passage. I plead with you, don't miss next week. You don't have to come back again, just come next week, all right? I plead with you. But we're going to see that relationship. We see now this relationship between humanity and creation and between humanity and God. And next week we'll look at the relationship between husband and wife, between man and woman. Very interesting to just as a, this is for free, this is, you can do with this what you want, is that Eve was the only creation of God that was not created out of dirt. She was created out of the rib of Adam. The only living creature of God not created out of the ground of the earth. If you want to know why, or maybe have some more input of that, come next week, all right? That's for free. And so, in conclusion, what does it mean to be image bearers of God? What are the implications? Well, as image bearers, it means that we have a responsibility, first and foremost, to take care of God's creation. I just briefly mentioned this last time. It doesn't matter what your political stances are on things like global warming and whatever, but we as God's image bearers have a responsibility to care for this world. We must. That is why we delight in seeing forests grow and rivers clean, because we are God's representatives for His creation. We are here to make things better for His creation. It means that the state of the world should be of concern to us. Let me give you an example from the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, God made a law with the nation of Israel that when they work land and they plant fields, that they have to rest the land every seventh year. Meaning for 7 years, you can plant in a piece of land. For 6 years, you can plant in a piece of land. But the seventh year, God says, rest the land. Rest it. And if you go and speak to people who are experts in landscaping and all those type of things, they can tell you why, right? It's good for the ground. But you can also see God's concern here for the earth. And did you know for 490 years, for 490 years, Israel did not obey that command. They did never once rest any land. They just planted for 490 years. The land was working hard. They disobeyed God's command. And what's so interesting is when with one of the judgments that God pronounces on Israel when the kingdom of Babylon eventually comes and takes them away, one of the reasons why they will be taken away for 70 years is because 70 years, 490 years divided by 7 equals to 70. God is giving the land 70 years of rest from the nation of Israel's constant abuse of it. See, God cares for the earth. God cares for the land. We must share God's heart in that. As image bearers, we have a responsibility and a duty towards animals and creatures of this world. You might be sitting there wondering, well, how is this spiritual? Brothers and sisters, these are spiritual truths. We must be loving towards God's creatures and His creation. The book of Proverbs is full of proverbs mentioning people who are abusive to animals and God's judgment on them. The book of Proverbs is full of that. The book of Proverbs, many places state that you can judge the character of a person by how they treat their animal. There's a lot of truth in that. As image bearers, we are to be like God in practicing these attributes that God shares us. As image bearers, we reflect God. Do you know that throughout the Old Testament, if you've never read the Old Testament, if you had, you'd notice it, that one of the constant offenses that God takes from the Old Testament is the creation of idols. Idols, it's something they create as a representative of God or a deity, and then they worship these idols. And God is always angry towards the creation of idols throughout the Old Testament. And do you know why? Because we are the image of God. You and I, we as humanity, and now people in the Old Testament go and they make an idol. They carve a piece of wood and they put it on the table and they say, this is the image of God. This is the God we worship. And God hates that because God cannot be represented by something that is not even able to breathe or grow or interact. God despises idolatry because it belittles Him. We are the living, breathing, thinking, worshiping representations of the eternal, living, and glorious God. That is what God has made us to be. Unlike the gods, the false gods of the nations, whose idols and images are made from wood and stone and cannot do anything, God made living and breathing images of Himself for His glory, for His representation. And what is the point of an image? It's not a trick question. An image is made to image, right? An image is made to reflect something. We are to reflect God and not ourselves. Brothers and sisters, if you look at the statistics of the Western world, speaking specifically about Western Europe and the United States within the last 90 years, there is a very serious correlation that you will observe. As the self-esteem movement progressed, so also did the suicide rate among young people. And the correlation is perfectly parallel. Because if we are constantly teaching young people, or anyone for that matter, that you are enough, you are all you need, just believe in yourself. Listen, that might sound nice in the beginning, but very soon they will realize their limitations and their flaws. But if I am all I have, what hope do I have? Telling someone to believe in themselves is like taking someone to Niagara Falls or to the Swiss Alps and then locking them in a room full of mirrors. We are not made to reflect ourselves, but we are made to reflect God. That is healthy mental health, is to look outside yourself, not inwards into yourself or to yourself or for yourself, but to live for another, to live for someone who is greater, more precious, and more beautiful. You see, in my wallet, if you open my wallet, there's a small picture of my wife. But it's just that. It's a photo. When I come home from the office and I go home and I go sit on the chair, do I open up my wallet and take out that picture and say, oh, I missed you so much. Oh, come here. I just love you. No, I throw the wallet one side and I grab my wife. I love her. This picture is simply pointing towards her. It's reminding me of her. This picture is good, but the real thing is better. Brothers and sisters, we are representations of God. We are made in God's image. But we are simply an image, a photo pointing to someone much better. Let us not be obsessed with ourselves. Let us find joy in our Creator. Image bearers is people, all as image bearers, it means that all people are precious to God. All people have a role as a representative. Everyone, without exception, believer or unbeliever. Doesn't matter their culture, doesn't matter their language, doesn't matter their social status, doesn't matter their economical status, doesn't matter their race. All people are precious to God because all people were created in the image of God. If you go to the last book of the Bible, in Revelation chapter 7, there is a very beautiful chapter that is quickly becoming one of my favorite chapters within the Bible. In Revelation chapter 7, listen to these words. John the Apostle is in heaven. God has invited him in, and he is seeing things that no man has ever seen before, and he's writing them down. And this is what he sees. He's in heaven. Verse 9, Revelation 7, verse 9. After this I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number. From every tribe, from every nation, all peoples and languages, standing before the throne of God, worshiping the Lamb, clothed in white robes, with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. You see what John sees in heaven? Not one group, not a colorblind spectrum. All peoples, all nations, all tribes, all languages, because it is beautiful to God. That is how God intended it to be. You see these things? If you know anything about history, what is one thing that history shows you? That people who come from different backgrounds and different geographical locations always fight. Always. They can even have the same skin color and they'll still kill each other like the Afrikaners and the English did. People always fight because there's always something that divides. Language, race, tribe, whatever. But in heaven, you see all these people who, humanly speaking, have nothing in common, who has always fighted together, in unison, worshiping the one who is on the throne, one who is greater than themselves, one who is outside themselves. This is what it means to be made in the image of God. We point to someone better, to Jesus Christ, our God who sits on the throne. And so, brothers and sisters, just as a side note, just as a short application, what we see from Genesis chapter 1 to 3 is that, simply put, racism is wrong. But not only is racism wrong, racism is heresy. You know what heresy is? Heresy is a false teaching. Heresy is something that contradicts the Bible. Racism is heresy because all people were made in the image of God. One is not better than another simply by means of the amount of pigment his skin displays. And so, the imago Dei, the image of God, is something that all of us have. But now, let's maybe close by asking a last question. Did we lose the image of God because of our sin? Adam and Eve were created in God's image, but that was before the fall. Did they, after the sin they committed and because of our sins, did we lose the image of God? Well, simply put, no. Genesis chapter 9, verse 6, after the fall, even after the flood, God again affirms that humanity is created in his image. James chapter 3 in the New Testament, James writes that the reason we must be careful how we speak to people is because people are made in the image of God. We cannot insult someone who is a representative of God and the very next moment worship God. Genesis chapter 5 again repeats that. That the image of God is something that we still have, but because of our sin, it has now been distorted. It has been corrupted. When Adam was originally made in the image of God, it doesn't mean that he was perfect. But, as we mentioned last time, there's larger teaching that we will engage in regarding the tree of knowledge and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and why did God put that tree there. But for time's sake, I see our time is running out, so I'll pick that up next time. Again, that's another reason for you to come back. Why didn't God just put a fence around the tree? No, there's a reason. There's a reason for that. So no, we did not lose our image of God because of sin, but it is corrupted. It is distorted. That is why the New Testament stops using the language of the image of God, and instead starts using the language of Christ-likeness. Because Christ, who is God, has come to save a people for himself, and we, as those who are in his church, as those who belong to Christ, what are we growing in? Christ-likeness. We are growing in becoming more like our Lord, more like our Savior. And so, in short, it means that we are growing and being restored to what it means to be in the full image of God. But now it's only possible for those who trust in Christ. And so all humanity bears a semblance of the image of God. That image has been distorted by sin, but the true image can only be restored in Christ. And to be in the image of God is to have relationship with God, to have responsibilities from God, and to represent God. That, brothers and sisters, is the purpose of life. And so then let's get back to those two questions. Who are you? You are an image bearer made to represent God in Christ Jesus. That's what you are. And who are you? Well, you are a sinner saved by grace, being conformed to the image of Christ for the glory of Christ. If you try and look for your identity outside of what God teaches, you would only result in depression, sadness, and frustration. Let God tell you what you are. Let God make it clear who you are. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we are so thankful for this opportunity that we have now done the second part in our mini-series for Genesis. Lord, I pray that this morning's sermon might fall on eager hearts and hearts that are eager to know who they are meant to be in your sight, so that they can also go into a broken world, Lord, a world where people do not know you and try to find meaning in themselves, Lord. May they not look to themselves. May they look to one who is more precious, more beautiful, one who is awesome and amazing, one who is love, joy, and light, our Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, please pull our hearts towards him. Lord, I pray for us as we now go this week and are planning, if it's your will, to meet next Sunday. Bring us together as we engage with probably the most important theme from Genesis chapter 1 and 2. Lord, I pray that you would bring all of us back, that we might learn what you want us to know. We pray this in your holy name. Thank you.